Of our series on our church's mission statement, and I'm going to invite you once again to join with me in reciting that. It's on the front cover of your bulletin. You don't have to have it memorized, but I'm hoping that we can work as a congregation towards actually memorizing that. It's not long or complex. Let's read that together. Our mission is to glorify God by making disciples, connect the community, grow in faith, serve in joy. Today we're on that last phrase, service in joy. I'm going to invite you, we've been sitting for a little bit, as able, if you would please rise for the reading of the gospel lesson. This is from the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. Let's listen to God's word. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Now the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, tied a towel around himself. And then he poured water into a basin, and he began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. Now, when he came to Simon Peter, he said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" "You don't know what I am doing, but later you will understand," Jesus answered. Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." And then Simon Peter said to him, "Well, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who is bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. You are clean, though not all of them." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of them are clean." Now, after he had washed their feet, he put on his robe, and he had returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your teacher and your Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set an example for you, that you also should do as I have done for you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may find your seat. Well, this may well be the most un-American sermon you're going to hear. I know that's a scary beginning to a sermon. No, I'm not going to criticize President Obama, nor Donald Trump, or Hillary Clinton, nor am I going to attack the U.S. Congress, apple pie, motherhood, cyclones, or the Hawkeyes, and I'm especially going to steer clear of those last two because I know what kind of people you are. No, what I want to explore this morning is the American infatuation with upward mobility. Upward mobility, of course, is the ability for people to move up the social ladder, right? To move up in power and position. Money and prestige and power and so forth. And let's be honest, we Americans are an upwardly mobile kind of people. We like that. We like words like promotion and ascension and going up and winning and increasing. And we define success as an increase in salary, the gross national product, and an ever-increasing Dow Jones average, right, Pete? That's what we like, right? And then there's our love affair with rags to riches stories. We love stories of people like John D. Rockefeller and Henry Ford and Oprah Winfrey and Bill Gates, people who started out with next to nothing and who rose up and up and up and up. And there's good things in those stories. I'm not putting that down. Hard work and diligence and effort, that's all awesome stuff. We love that American mobility. But our gospel reading this morning is a story of a different kind of mobility. It's a story of a God who doesn't rise, but rather a God who stoops down to serve other people. It is, in short, a story of downward mobility. It's a story, first of all, of what happened on the last night that Jesus was with his disciples. The 12 had had a long day out on the dusty roads of Palestine, and they were looking forward to celebrating a quiet Passover meal with their rabbi. But as soon as they arrived there in the upper room, they discovered a problem, a big problem. There was no servant there to wash everybody's feet. Now, normally, when a Jewish person came in from a dusty road, a non-Jewish slave would clean off the dirt and the grime and the sweat and so forth that had accumulated on everybody's feet. But there was no servant in this household for some reason, Jewish or otherwise. And so they all looked around at one another and said, well, who's going to wash the feet? Well, we know from the other Gospels that just a little bit while earlier, while they were on the road, in fact, coming up into that upper room, that they were arguing with one another about who the greatest one was amongst the disciples. Was it John, or was it Peter, or was it James? And they fought back and forth about this. Each was making his bid to be the chief executive officer of the new kingdom that Jesus was about to usher in. To pick up the basin and the towel would be the equivalent of saying that I give up on that I'm going to accept the role of the chief executive officer, a janitor, not the chief executive officer. So nobody budged until Jesus picked up the towel and the basin himself. It's hard for us in our culture to understand just how completely radical Jesus' actions are in this passage. On an exceptionally rare occasion, the disciples might wash the feet of their rabbi in order to show their total devotion, their love for their rabbi. You might possibly see that on a very rare occasion, but it was unthinkable for a rabbi to wash the feet of his disciples. That never happens. And so Peter is rightfully outraged. Lord, are you going to wash my feet? I mean, this isn't the way it's supposed to be, Peter's saying. I mean, does President Obama wash the dishes after a steak dinner? That's not how this is supposed to go, Jesus. But Jesus had a point to make. And he didn't take that lower position just because nobody else would. He didn't do it because he was angry with the disciples somehow, and he wanted to kind of get back at them in a backhanded kind of a way. He didn't do it because he was one of those codependent people, you know, who always has to come along and rescue other people and solve the problem, and, you know, really weak need someone, but always there, oh, you know, lowly Jesus here. No, he wasn't. Didn't do it for any of those reasons. On the contrary, he washed their feet precisely because of his unshakable sense of personal identity and strength. The Gospel of John goes out of the way to make that point. Verse 3 says, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God, and that he was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Oh no, he didn't do it out of weakness, he did it out of strength. He must be a strong person in order to be a person who can serve others. Jesus fully aware that all of the created world was his, completely conscious that he had existed before time began, absolutely cognizant of the fact that he was going back to God in glory, took off his robe, got down on his hands and his knees, and washed the dirt that he had created at the beginning of time off of the feet of the disciples that he had formed when they were in their mother's womb. But Jesus' downward mobility is even more shocking when we understand that in John's gospel, this story functions as more than just a historical recollection of the last thing that Jesus did with his disciples before they celebrated Passover. Oh no, this isn't just a historical story. John is telling us, wants us to know that what happened here on that last night is symbolic of Jesus' entire existence. His whole life was a foot washing. The verb used there in verse 4 for Jesus taking off his robe is a very powerful word in the Greek. A better translation is he laid down his robe. That phrase, laid down, occurs some 21 times in John's gospel. The verb appears in John chapter 10, verse 11, for instance, where Jesus says that the good shepherd lays down his life for his friends. And in John 15, 13, Jesus says that no one has greater love than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. You see what John is saying here? Just as Jesus laid down his robe, so he laid down his positions of power and glory that he held along with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Just as he tied a towel around himself, most scholars believe that he tied fragile human flesh around himself in his incarnation. Just as he laid down his robe, so he, the good shepherd, would later on lay down his life, his very life, for his friends. And just as he took up his robes again, so he would take up his position in the Holy Trinity after the resurrections. Oh, my dear friends, our voices ought to tremble as we ponder the depth of downward mobility that Jesus Christ took on for our salvation. Just try to wrap your brains around what this must have been like for Jesus. Would you please? Jesus Christ, co-eternal with the Father and with the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ, completely equal in divinity to the Father and the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ, omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, who was from the beginning and shall be forevermore. Jesus Christ, who was accustomed to the whole angelic host of heaven, bowing down before him and crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is to come." Jesus Christ, this same Jesus Christ, left it all and descended to earth in order to become humanity's servant. I mean, he had to go through doors. He divested himself of it all. As Philippians chapter 2 says, he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, a slave, and being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and he became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Now, Jesus didn't just wash our feet. He washed away all of our sins, all of our guilt, all of our shame, so that we might be spotless and blameless before God. That is the depth of the service that Jesus has rendered unto you and I and all of humanity. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Amen. And that's the imperative, or the indicative, what God has done. Now, the second part of the sermon is the imperative, what we're to do in response to what God has done, right? It is this kind of downward mobility for for the sake of serving others, that Jesus would have us emulate for one another. If I, your Lord and your teacher, have washed your feet, so you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, so that you should do as I have done for you. This downward mobility stuff isn't just for Jesus. It's for all people who would claim the name of Jesus, to walk in his footsteps, to be a disciple of him. As Christians, we are to follow Jesus down into the realms of service for others for the sake of God's kingdom. And so the final phrase of our mission statement is that we are to serve in joy. Serve in joy. Each of us is to lay down our own positions of power and authority and offer them up to God as our response to God's grace. Whatever God has entrusted to us, our education, our careers, our financial resources, our skills, our talents, our abilities, all of those things are to be rendered, to be laid down before our Father, saying, Lord, do with them as you please. I don't have a lot in my life, but these are the things that I do have. I will never serve you the same way you have served me, but this is what I can do, and so I do it in gratitude for your gift to me. And that attitude of servanthood is to permeate the church's whole life, the church's corporate existence, is to be characterized by that attitude of servanthood towards one another and towards the world around us. As Christ poured out his life for us, so we are to pour out our life for one another and for the world around us, doing whatever it takes to bring other people closer to the Lord Jesus Christ, to bear witness to his goodness. Those in our Monday night Bible study, our small group this meeting there, have been using a curriculum by a pastor by the name of Adam Hamilton. Adam is the pastor of Church of the Resurrection in Overland Park, Kansas. Well, a couple of years ago, I was at a conference where Adam Hamilton was one of the speakers, and he told a story about an event that was pivotal in the early life of his church. Apparently, a single mother was interested in their church, and he was visiting with this woman, and she had a son who was severely mentally disabled, and he needed constant attention. And she said that she would like to come to their little church, but that it would mean that someone would have to stay with him during worship and Sunday school the whole time, and that quite honestly, he was so severely mentally retarded that that would be quite scary for the average person. And so she said, thank you very much for the kind offer of coming to worship with you, but it's obviously not going to work out. But Hamilton told her that he had been preaching to his congregation about servanthood, and that he would take this request, this need, to the elders of the church and see what they said. Now, at that time, they were averaging about 65 people in worship and meeting in a funeral home. What else do you call a church that meets in a funeral home but Church of the Resurrection, right? I love that. Anyway, it would be no small thing for a church of 65 people to get together to volunteer to do such a scary thing. But Hamilton, again, thought that he would give it a shot with his elders. And so he laid it before them, and the elders, the leadership, led the way in signing up to stay with this child during Sunday school and during the worship hour. So the woman came to church. And you know, that woman knew another family that had a severely disabled child. She invited them, and they started coming to church. And that family knew another family that had a severely disabled child. And so they invited another person, they started coming to church. And pretty soon, they had a support group in that church for people who had severely disabled children. And pretty soon, word got out in that community that that little church that met out in the funeral home, well, holy smokes, you wouldn't believe it, but they really cared about people. They would do whatever it took to reach out to them and to bring them into God's fold. Do you know what the average worship attendance is at Church of the Resurrection today? Give or take a couple hundred, about 10,000, up from 65. Now, not all of that growth is due to the fact that that church embodied servanthood, but Adam Hamilton will tell you that the pivotal event in the life of that congregation was the day that they were at that session meeting and those elders said, I'll sign up to sit with that child. Because that event cemented within the psyche, within the DNA of that congregation, a whatever it takes attitude that they have never, ever lost. And that's what's driven their growth, at least according to Hamilton. Wow. So let me ask you, is St. Paul a whatever it takes kind of a congregation? Are we willing to do whatever it takes to serve one another here within our church and also to serve those that are outside of the walls of our church? Whatever it takes in terms of time or energy or finances or even discomfort on our own part, are we willing to do whatever it takes to reach out to our children and to our youth with the gospel of Christ? There are indeed signs that we are that kind of a church. We have some wonderful servants in our congregation, doing some wonderful selfless ministries. And yet, there are probably also other areas where we still may have a little bit to go. It's hard, isn't it? It's incredibly difficult, in fact, for us to lay down our lives for others like Christ did. In fact, I would say it's impossible under human effort. We are all pretty much clingers by nature. We cling to our position. We cling to our power. We cling to our pride and our possessions like children fighting over a toy in the sandbox, don't we? Incredibly, we even think that the church is ours. And yet we know it isn't. It's Jesus' church, isn't it? He's our Lord and our Savior. And so he invites us to do, he wants to do for us that which we cannot do for ourselves. He invites us to allow him to wash away our sins every day of our lives. We mustn't be like Peter, who pridefully refused to let Jesus cleanse himself. Unless I wash you, Jesus says, you can have no part in me. The Good News Bible says, you can't be my disciple unless you let me wash your feet. Unless we allow Jesus to serve us, admit our sins, and allow him to wash those away, there is no hope of us serving anybody else. If we're not allowing that, if we're not allowing him to wash us, if we're not allowing him to fill us on a daily basis with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control, all of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, if we don't allow that, then it is impossible for us to achieve what Jesus has set out for us in this passage. And yet, if we allow him to cleanse us daily, if we live in fellowship with him, if we rely upon him in prayer and Bible study, and if we come together, then we have this incredible promise, not only that serving other people is possible, but even that it can be joyful. It can be joyful. If you know these things, says Jesus, this is the Good News translation of the last verse. If you know these things, how happy you will be if you put them into practice. How happy you will be if you will serve other people. Life is a funny thing, isn't it? You know, the more we keep it to ourselves, the less of it we have. And the more we give away to other people, the more of it we do have. On Monday evening, Val Beecher texted me after she had finished leading that Monday night group that we were talking about earlier. The text read simply, "Fantastic class tonight. My heart is full. Peace. My heart is full. Peace." Is your heart full? Are you at peace? This is Jesus' will, his plan, his purpose for all of his followers. And the paradox of life with God is that we get a full heart by giving ourselves away, by emptying ourselves into the lives of other people. As we pour our lives out in service, God pours joy into our hearts. And so Jesus sends us out, corporately and individually. He sends us out on a mission from God, a mission to glorify God by making disciples who connect in community, who grow in faith, and who serve. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. God, the depth of our service to others will be determined by the depth of our understanding of what you have done for us. When you ask, "Do you understand what I've done for you?" that question is for each and every one of us. Break us over, Lord, so that we can understand the depth and the breadth and the height of